worship and sing together.
Welcome to Redeemer Church. And the reason we sang that song, we're going to be looking at the very famous story of David and Goliath in a few moments. And so you notice the theme of our worship service this morning is we worship the Lord, our champion. One of the things that we all face on a day-to-day basis is this concept of fear. And we all have fears and we all have doubts at times we go through in our lives. But with the Lord, we have a champion who's fought the fight for us. So let's call each other to worship from Psalm 27. And hear the word of the Lord. The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the stronghold of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? When evildoers assail me to eat up my flesh, my adversaries and foes, it is they who stumble and fall. Though an army encamp against me, my heart shall not fear. Though war arise against me, yet I will be confident. One thing have I asked of the Lord, that will I seek after, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to gaze upon the beauty of the Lord and to inquire in his temple. Let's worship the Lord together.
How firm a foundation, you saints of the Lord, is laid for your faith in his excellent word. What more can he say than to you he has said, to you who for refuge to Jesus have fled? Help you and cause you to stand upheld by my right.
Himself, who is our champion, and the incredible importance of placing our trust only in Him. Let us confess our faith together from a very famous verse from Proverbs 1:7. I ask you this morning, Christian, what do you believe? We believe that the fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge. Fools despise wisdom and instruction. 'Tis so sweet to trust in Jesus. Let's continue to worship Him together.
Trust Him.
Please pray with me. Our God and our King, Father, indeed, we come into your presence this morning knowing that you, the Lord, is our shepherd. We shall not want. You make us lie down in green pastures. You lead us beside still waters. You restore our soul. You lead us in paths of righteousness for your name's sake. And even though at times we walk through the valley of the shadow of death, we will fear no evil, for you are with us. Your rod and your staff, they comfort us. You prepare a table before us in the presence of our enemies. You anoint our head with oil. Our cup overflows. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow us all the days of our lives, and we shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Father, there is nothing more to say simply than thank you, and we love you, and we recognize that you have first loved us. In the precious name of your Son, our Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Before you're seated, please turn and greet one another here this morning.
Bring you a warm greeting once again to Redeemer Church. Glad to have you here worshiping in God's house. I'm excited that you are here. If you are new to our church and would like some more information about our church, there's an insert in your bulletin you can fill out and drop it in the offering plate later on the service. We'd love to get you some more information about our church. Or if you have prayer requests, we get those each and every week. Please fill those out in the back and put them in the offering plate as well. We do have a change. Zach's here, but we're going to baptize him in a couple weeks when his sister can be here. If you look, follow along in the bulletin. But also, I have one announcement. Who here has got some things they're frustrated about in life right now? Well, this Saturday morning at 8 o'clock is for you. If you want to pound some nails and dig out some wood, we're going to be doing a work project to repair the deck over there at the property of our old building over there. So come at 8 o'clock, see a deacon afterwards. They want to know who's coming to help. We're going to replace the front deck, which we've done a couple times, but it's a lot of fun just to be together. So come if you can and see a deacon immediately after this service. Yesterday was another great day in the life of our church. We just finished up another season of Boy at Sports. And so as Dwayne's going to come up and talk about that, let's give Dwayne a hand. He's been doing this for a long time. So
yeah, I wouldn't do this without the Lord. I mean, this doesn't work without him. Every year we have challenges. I'm sorry I have a voice problem, but I have a sinus congestion. But anyway, we had a great, great year. We had no cancellation, no rain problems. We had some dust problems because of lack of rain and some fire ants. But anyway, it was a great season. You know, we had over 85 families there, 125 kids coming out every week for 8 weeks. We had over 35 volunteers coming out every week to put this ministry together. It's not my ministry, it's the Lord's ministry. And the encouraging thing that I saw was how many times we had our coaches out there consistently every week. I mean, they had to get up Saturday morning after working all week or going to school and being out there. And it's just encouraging to see the commitment that they have to these families. So first of all, Debbie Hansen, I really want to thank all those that participated in Boy at Sports. The coaches that were key to this ministry, talking to the families and their kids, to the all the youth that came out. I can tell you the families that come out and see that the Redeemer have youth that come out on a Saturday morning to help their kids. Rather than sleeping in like a normal teenager, that it really encourages them to see that there's youth out there that way. And for all the people that came out and helped with the food and sweated, I know Aggie's out here. She was out there on Saturday mornings sweating with everybody, getting the food ready for the picnic that we have every time after the soccer. And for all the other field preparations, I mean, it's just countless. It's about 35, as I said, over 30 each week coming out and doing this ministry. So there's no question of the commitment level of this church to this ministry. So yesterday we did ask the families to give us some comments. So I wanted to read some of those comments to you, just so you know some of the impacts. And I won't mention the coaches' names, because a lot of times they mention the coach. But our coach was very nice. He knew how to speak to the kids. My daughter felt safe in this environment. He spoke at their level, and they understood what he was saying. We enjoy Boyer Sports more than any other place we've tried. We've been coming for years, and we will continue to come. Our coach had a great relationship with our kids. It was a great experience, non-competitive, but very fun. It was our first soccer experience, and we loved it. And it was such a great learning environment and awesome, encouraging coaches. I mean, that's where you're impacting these peoples for Christ, when they can see the love of Christ pouring out on their kids from our coaches. Very important. Now, during our 8 weeks, we also have a devotion time where there's actually three different devotions that go on based on age group. Will does one, Craig does one, and Paul Tompkins does one. Yeah, by the way, Paul, you can sell your house now. The season's over. I told him he couldn't sell us. I was praying you wouldn't sell your house until the season's out. I'm sorry, but that's the truth. Anyway, you can sell the house now, okay? So here's some comments about the devotions. Love the time with God. We have absolutely enjoyed the love and patience given to our children. Devotion time is our favorite. And our final one that I'm going to read to you is devotions were kid-friendly and very well connected with biblical principles with aspects of soccer. And we do. We kind of integrate the soccer ball, or something relating to how who God is and how important it is in our personal lives. So our main vision this year was to impact these families for Christ. And I think we never know who we impact at all times, but we know that we have spread the gospel during these 8 weeks to these families. And I appreciate, again, all the support that this congregation has given. Now, I do want to mention one person. Tyler Kleitz has been on my speed dial all season, even before the season started. And he's helped me with the fields, with photography, with anything I've called him to do. He's been gracious. And he has put together this video that you're going to see in a few seconds, just to show you what Boya Sports is about. So again, thank you all that volunteered again. Debbie and I appreciate all the support you guys give to this ministry. Enjoy the video.
With my kids, because one, we get to learn about Christ. Two, it's great team spirit. We get to play sports with them as parents and kids. And three, we get to socialize. The best part about it.
So that my grandson can get experience in something that's both practical and spiritual. He can learn to work with others and learn about Christ at the same time. What we have inside.
Okay, well, we came to Boya Sports because our neighbor, Coach Paul, and Miss Lisa told us about their wonderful church and the wonderful soccer program that they have here. And we were excited to come here and see what it was all about. For all the times we run ahead, call us back to where your heart is.
learned about Boyette sports from my friend Dina, and I have a grandson who is best friends with her child, so we thought we would come and check it out. We knew nothing about it. Had so much to offer for someone like me who's on a real tight budget. It's family oriented, non-competitive, and a really nice, homey, friendly environment. We're really happy here.
We're here because both of my girls are able to play soccer. I have a 6 and a 4, and they're side by side and safe and good people and people who love the Lord, and we're on a very good, safe place to be. That's why we're here.
See the video at the end of the year. My particular favorite is clutter ball with my little friends. The ball goes that way and then 15 little friends follow it, right, and back and forth. So as Dwayne said, thank you so much for everyone who helped out with Boyette Sports. Such a great, great ministry. Please join me for a time of intercessory prayer as we continue to worship the Lord. Father, again, we come into your presence very humbly and very thankfully. And God, even seeing a 3-minute video was a reminder of all the hard work that people did, but more importantly, Father, we pray that seeds of truth, that seeds of the gospel were planted deep in the hearts of men and women and children. Even Dwayne said it, we may not know the impact exactly that was made, but Father, we desire to be agents of truth. We desire to be salt and light to a watching world, and we pray, Lord, for these families and these moms and dads and grandparents and children, many who have come for many, many years, and we pray, Lord, that we would continue to be able to impact them for your glory with the saving message of the gospel. And we thank you for all those that helped and gave up Saturday after Saturday, whether it was doing something like cooking or greeting folks or coaching or doing devotion or prepping fields or whatever it may have been. Thank you so much for everyone who served. Father, we also continue just to pray, recognizing that it is your desire for us as a church to point people towards you. And part of that, Father, is our involvement in missions. And so, Father, we thank you for the missionaries that we're able to support. Father, we pray this morning for Ken and Tammy Matlack. We thank you for their work overseas. We pray, Lord, that you would strengthen them and that you would encourage them. We pray that you would bear much fruit in and through their lives through the ministry that you've called them to. We also pray for Dave and Aaron Purvis as well, Father, as they too continue to labor for you. We pray that you would bless their family, provide for their needs. God, give them opportunity after opportunity to give the reason for the hope that they have in you, Jesus. And Father, we thank you for Kelly Ford, and we thank you for her work with Rafiki, and we thank you for even the transitions she's going through, moving to another village. We pray that you would bless her and watch over her, that, Lord, you would continue to use her to be salt and light, to be a voice for truth over in Africa in the villages that you call her to. Father, we also recognize that there are many health needs that people are facing. We pray particularly for Cindy Trembley this week as she has her surgery this Friday. Lord, we ask for your protection and provision for her. Father, we ask that you would be with the surgeons, that you would give great precision, that you would use them, that you would watch over her as only you can. Father, we also pray for Mr. Bergen, for Jerry Bergen, as he was facing some heart issues for the past couple of days while he was vacationing in Tallahassee. We pray, Lord, that you would be with he and his wife Beverly, Lord, that you would watch over him, that you would give them wisdom as they proceed in the coming days and make decisions and things of the sort. But thank you for watching over him. Father, we also pray for Naomi Melendez. Father, we pray for Leilani and Eric's little baby daughter, and thank you for the surgery that she had this past Thursday. Thank you that things went well with that surgery. Father, we pray that you would strengthen her little heart. God, we also pray that she would not have to have any more surgeries, that things that they were hoping to see, that they would see as she gets older and as she grows and as her body develops. We pray that you would watch over her. And we pray for her, Father, that she would not just know your physical provision and protection of her. But Lord, we pray that there's never a day where she does not know you as her Lord and Savior. And so, Lord, we pray for Leilani and Eric as well as they walk through this difficult time with a young child, as well at the same time parenting their other children. We pray that you would bless them and watch over them. Father, thank you for loving us so very much. Thank you for the opportunity this morning to come to worship you and to be reminded that while at times in our lives we face obstacles and things that are just outright scary and we don't know how to handle them, Father, we are reminded this morning that you are a God who fights for his people, and we thank you for that. Father, may we continue to worship you now as we offer our tithes and gifts to you, and may we do so with a cheerful heart. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
This song is about Jesus, our comforter. In this place of despair, I know you are there. It feels like my heart is breaking, yet all this time you are making me new. Show me the way, show me the way. Show me the way, show me the way. You said, let my heart be still, and also said, let it be thy will. Yet I feel nothing but loss. I can't understand the cost, and show me the way, show me the way. This time you've been taking my burden as your own, and so I can sit at your throne. For you are the way, you are the way.
Text this morning is from 1 Samuel chapter 17. I'm just going to read the last, pretty much the last third of it, but let's stand together as we hear the word of the Lord. Starting in verse 32 of 1 Samuel 17. And David said to Saul, "Let no man's heart fail because of him. Your servant will go and fight with this Philistine." And Saul said to David, "You are not able to go against this Philistine to fight with him, for you are but a youth, and he has been a man of war from his youth." But David said to Saul, "Your servant used to keep sheep for his father. And when there came a lion or a bear and took a lamb from the flock, I went after him and struck him and delivered it out of his mouth. And if he arose against me, I caught him by his beard and struck him and killed him. Your servant has struck down both lions and bears, and this uncircumcised Philistine shall be like one of them, for he has defied the armies of the living God." And David said, "The Lord who delivered me from the paw of the lion and from the paw of the bear will deliver me from the hand of this Philistine." And Saul said to David, "Go, and the Lord be with you." Then Saul clothed David with his armor. He put a helmet of bronze on his head and clothed him with a coat of mail, and David strapped his sword over his armor. And he tried in vain to go, for he had not tested them. Then David said to Saul, "I cannot go with these, for I have not tested them." So David put them off. Then he took his staff in his hand and chose 5 smooth stones from the brook and put them in his shepherd's pouch. His sling was in his hand, and he approached the Philistine. And the Philistine moved forward and came near to David with his shield bearer in front of him. And when the Philistine looked and saw David, he disdained him, for he was but a youth, ruddy and handsome in appearance. And the Philistine said to David, "Am I a dog that you come to me with sticks?" And the Philistine cursed David by his gods. The Philistine said to David, "Come to me, and I will give your flesh to the birds of the air and to the beasts of the field." Then David said to the Philistine, "You come to me with a sword and with a spear and with a javelin, but I come to you in the name of the Lord of hosts, the God of the armies of Israel, whom you have defied. This day the Lord will deliver you into my hand, and I will strike you down and cut off your head. And I will give the dead bodies of the host of the Philistines this day to the birds of the air and to the wild beasts of the earth, that all the earth may know that there is a God in Israel, and that all this assembly may know that the Lord saves not with sword and spear, for the battle is the Lord's, and he will give you into our hand." When the Philistine arose and came and drew near to meet David, David ran quickly toward the battle line to meet the Philistine. And David put his hand in his bag and took out a stone and slung it, and struck the Philistine on his forehead. The stone sank into his forehead, and he fell on his face to the ground. So David prevailed over the Philistine with a sling and with a stone, and struck the Philistine and killed him. There was no sword in the hand of David. This is the very word of God.
When you pass through the waters, I will be with you, and the wave shall not overcome you. Do not fear, for I have redeemed you. I have called you by name. Lord, I am the Lord.
Father, often we don't really look honestly at our fears because our fears are what drive us to live the lives that we live. And we all have deep-seated fears in each of our lives, things that we don't want to admit that we're afraid of, but we really are. Those things that we love the most, that if we lost them, we would be terrified if we didn't have them. And we all have those things. And so this morning, as we look at this concept, would we see our Lord Jesus, our true champion, the Lord of hosts, so we can walk through life not without fear, but able to really see that the Lord has won the battle for us in the midst of our fear. And I ask now as we look at this word that we would hear it, make it come alive to our hearts once again, this very familiar story. And I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. We will dismiss our children for Children's Church, and the rest of you may be seated. And as the children are being dismissed, if you'd like to follow along, there's an outline that you can follow along in for you in your bulletin. We have just begun a series in which we're looking into the life of David. We will look at his early life, his improbable ascension into power, that is, his becoming king of Israel, while contrasting his life with King Saul, who was bred for kingship. We'll look at how his career became unraveled as he fell into sin time and time again, and even at his friendship with Jonathan. But let me remind you one more time as we look at this text, that the primary way to look at the Bible, even the Old Testament, is to look first and foremost as to what it teaches us about God, and even more specifically, what it teaches us about Jesus. The amazing thing that I found through the years is that the Bible always points us to Jesus. The Old Testament looks forward to Jesus and his finished work on the cross. And the New Testament looks back to Jesus and his finished work on the cross. With that in mind, we come this morning to what probably is the most famous, the most dramatic, and yes, the most often told story in the life of David. This event would be one of those summer blockbuster-worthy stories of the Bible. And actually, in it, we face one of the most fundamental questions about life addressed, and that issue is how to deal with fear. Now, you're probably not going to hear this story this morning in ways you've heard it before, because when I've heard all these stories in my life about Goliath, we often look at him as we look at Goliath, to look at the large fears that we face in life, and look at him as an example of how we're to handle our fears that come our way. In other words, we're to summon up this courage, how to banish our fears and face them head on. You know, the bigger they are, the harder they fall, right? I remember the first crush I had on a girl, her name was Shelley. And this was a long time ago, and I remember the tremendous fear that I had about summoning up the courage to call her on the telephone and ask her out. And I had one of those rotary dial phones, and so I'd ring the first three numbers of the phone, and then I'd hang up. And then I'd summon up the courage to ring four numbers on the phone and then hang up. Now, I know some of you people are reliving what I just mentioned in your minds. And some of us look at the story in like manner. If David could take on Goliath, then surely I can face the rejection of a girl and ask her out. If that's the only way you look at this text, let me tell you, that's pretty a shallow understanding of this text, probably an even improper way of reading this text. Because this text is about those deep-seated fears that happen in our lives on a daily basis. It could be as simple as all the things we have in the back of our minds, the fear now that we have of terrorism attacks that 9/11 brought to us, or even deeper than that. This story talks about the fear that keeps you up at night, the fear of failure, the fear of rejection, the fear of losing control, the fear of approval or loss of it, the fear of alienation, the fear of the loss of things that mean the most to you. And in this story, we see how the Bible addresses those deep-seated fears. And we're going to do it looking through the lens of the three main players in this text. Who are the three main players of this text? They are King Saul, Goliath, and David. And in the end, I'm going to conclude by having us look at who we really identify with in this story. And it's none of those three characters. It really is the Israelites themselves. And then to show you how we can face our fears and actually live courageous lives for Christ and his kingdom as we trust in him. Like General von Zeeland, who was a devout Christian and one of the most trusted officers of the Prussian king, if you've read in history, Frederick the Great. Frederick the Great was known widely as this agnostic, and they were having this one festive evening together, and the king began making these crude jokes about Jesus, and everyone soon was rocking with laughter, all but General von Zeeland, that is. Finally, he arose, and he addressed the king, and he said this, "Sire, you know I have not feared death. I have fought and won 38 battles for you. I am an old man. I shall soon have to go into the presence of one greater than you, the mighty God who saved me from my sin, the Lord Jesus Christ, whom you are blaspheming. I salute you, sire, as an old man who loves his Savior on the edge of eternity." And the place went silent. And finally, the king stood up and said, "General von Zeeland, I beg your pardon. I beg your pardon." And that ended the party. How are we to deal with our fears? Because we all face them. I just want to look at the three main players of this text first. First note, the faltering courage of the reigning king. The faltering courage of the reigning king. Now, this story is actually 50 verses long or so, and we didn't read it all, but just let me tell you what happens in the beginning. Israel and the Philistines are mortal enemies, and they're now to enter this fierce battle. To add to the drama, the Philistines are on one hill. There's a valley in between them, and the Israelites are on another hill. So it's kind of like the valley is the danger zone or the steel cage that you go in and the battle will be fought. For every day, for 40 days, this huge Philistine, Goliath, comes out and says, "Hey, why don't you choose a man and send out who will fight me to the death? And if we win, you will become our servants and our slaves. But if we win, if you win, we will become your servants and slaves." In essence, Goliath is calling out Saul. Look at verse 4 of our text. Let me read it to you. "And there came out from the camp of the Philistines a champion named Goliath of Gath, whose height was 6 cubits and a span." The key word in that verse is the word champion. Because that word in the Hebrew means more than victor, not the one that simply wins all the time. It literally means this in the Hebrew, the man between. The one who will fight for us, or the one who will fight on behalf of us. Now, quite honestly, this was a pretty good idea. Two men would fight in battle, only one person would die in the battle. If the champion was on your side, you would win and get all the spoils, but if he lost, then you'd become the servants or the subjects of the champion's army. That champion would become your representative. Not because he won necessarily, but because he fought on behalf of you. So if he wins on your behalf, you win. And if he loses on your behalf, you lose. Think of the Olympic Games, the Summer Olympics, the last several Summer Olympics. We all watched Michael Phelps win gold medal after gold medal, and we just say, when he won, we won. They play the national anthem after he wins the gold medal, right? But before we get to Goliath, let me ask you, who was at present Israel's champion? It was Saul, who by all accounts was a very impressive person in his own right. Listen to how 1 Samuel 9 describes him. 1 Samuel 9 says this, "And he," that would be Benjamin, the father of Saul, "had a son whose name was Saul, a handsome young man. There was not a man among the people of Israel more handsome than he. From his shoulders upward, he was taller than any of the people." Saul, in his own right, was a skilled warrior, who had already been involved in several successful military campaigns. You could say that King Saul was a king that all the people wanted. And one of the chief responsibilities of a king was to be the champion of his people, to be their protector, to be their defender, to make decisions on behalf of. He was the one expected to lead Israel into battle. So here we have this Goliath, this giant of a man, going out into the danger zone every single day for 40 days, And screaming out, "Someone come out here and fight me, mano on mano." Which leads me to verse 11 of 1 Samuel 17, which says this, "When Saul and all Israel heard these words of the Philistine, they were dismayed and greatly afraid." Saul and the rest of the Israelite army were terrified by Goliath. Saul, who was the champion of Israel, he wilts. He's terrified. His courage falters. What was Saul's issue here? The heart of the matter of this text is not how to get Saul to go out and kick the Philistine's rear end. It's not how to overcome brawn with brains. It's not that every single giant has weakness. But David goes to the heart of the issue. The verse I read in verse 32, let no man's heart fail because of him. In other words, don't lose heart. Literally, David says, let no one's heart fall. When you're being threatened, will you stand fast or will you retreat? Like I said, we all have fears. One of the things I've had to deal with ever since I free fell 100 feet off a cliff was I realized later that I had this tremendous fear of heights after that. And I've had to ask the Lord time and time again to help me overcome that fear. But some of us are afraid of commitment. We are too afraid to get involved in a relationship because we've been hurt before. And we do not want to be hurt again because we don't want to be vulnerable again. Some of us are afraid of responsibility, even to the point we won't commit to anything, not even a church. Some of us are afraid of standing up for Jesus in the marketplace. Some of us compromise our ethics because we're afraid we'll lose any advancement in the marketplace. Some of us are afraid of drawing close to the Lord Jesus Christ because we're afraid he won't accept us as we are, or he'll reject us, or we may in fact have to deal with some sin in our lives that we don't want to deal with. In other words, all of us are cowards in some shape or form. Whatever you love the most, wherever your deepest affections lie, whatever those things are that you dread losing the most in this life, those things tend to paralyze us in fear. We're all, in essence, like the cowardly lion, or like Rocky Balboa in Rocky III as he's getting ready to fight Mr. T, Clubber Lane, and he has those great words on the beach, I don't want to train hard because I'm afraid. I'm paralyzed with fear. Robert Alter, in his commentary, who's an expert in the Hebrew narrative, says this Goliath was about 8 feet tall. Some of you heard 9 feet tall. He was between 7 and 9 feet tall, probably. Put it this way, he was huge, considering back then the average height of anybody was not more than 5 feet tall. Saul, who wasn't no slouch either as far as height goes, as the representative of Israel, should have been out confronting Goliath every single day, on the first day. But he wilts in fear, and it paralyzes him. Now, I don't know if you've read the book Pride and Prejudice or seen the movie. There are two ladies in that movie, Elizabeth Bennet and her neighbor Charlotte. On the one hand, you have Charlotte, who marries a Mr. Collins. Remember this? He's a mean, odious man who happens to be a pastor. I probably shouldn't say that, by the way. But I'm sure he wasn't a Presbyterian pastor, okay? Do you recall why Charlotte married Mr. Collins? Out of fear. She was afraid if she didn't marry him, she would never be married, so she married him not out of love, but out of convenience and security. On the other hand, you have Elizabeth, who turns down Mr. Collins' proposal earlier, even though she could have married him. She's decided to wait because she didn't love this man, and she found the man she loved, and she married him. And you have this contrasting stories between these two families. What do we learn from Saul's mistakes here? There are going to be many things that scare us, many things that even keep us up at night. But as we just sung, when you pass through the waters, when you face huge obstacles in life, the Lord will be with us, for he has redeemed us. He has called us by name, and we are his. So notice first, the faltering courage of the reigning king. Secondly, notice this, the counterfeit courage of the rival king. The counterfeit courage of the rival king. Here we have what 1 Samuel 17 says, the Philistine. He never uses his name Goliath. He's the champion of the Philistine army. He comes out every single day challenging any man to come out and fight him. Again, Robert Alter, in the expert in the Hebrew narrative, talks about this. He says that not only was Goliath this huge man, but he had the most advanced military hardware. He had all the gadgets. He had all the bells and all the whistles. Verses 5 and 7 of chapter 17 says this, that Goliath had a helmet of bronze on his head, and he was armed with a coat of mail, and the weight of the coat was 5,000 shekels of bronze. That's 125 pounds of armor. And he had bronze armor on his legs and a javelin of bronze slung between his shoulders. The shaft of his spear was like a weaver's beam, and his spear's head weighed 600 shekels of iron. Between 20 and 30 pounds was the tip of his spear. And his shield bearer went before him. Alter points out in this commentary, the expert in the Hebrew narrative, that you never, ever saw such a detailed list of what a man was wearing. And he writes this. The thematic purpose of this exceptional attention to physical detail is obvious. Goliath moves into the action like a man of iron and bronze, an almost grotesquely quantitative embodiment of a hero, a hulking monument to an obvious, obtusely mechanical conception of what constitutes power. And then when you read him, he talks about the mistake we often make when we think about Goliath. We often think that he represents what our fears are. That's how we read this. And so then David becomes this inspiring way in which we should handle our fears. And also said, that is not the way to interpret this text. He says that Goliath and David are alternate approaches to heroism. They're alternate approaches as to how we are to deal with our fears or to courage. In the case of Goliath, he had a counterfeit courage. What do I mean by that? Well, what did he trust in? Goliath sees this little guy, David, coming out to face him, and he says, come on, you're a small little runt right now. I'm huge. You come out here with a simple sling. Now, in fairness, that was a weapon, but he's like, I'm high tech. It's like we in the United States, when we take on a third world country, how are they going to fight us with the weapons that we have, right? There's no way a sling could ever infiltrate our armor. So Goliath builds himself up into this unbeatable force. He builds himself up by his own self-esteem as he shouts obscenity after obscenity towards Israel. In other words, he's trying to banish all fear from his mind. And by the way, this is the actual way that the world has always dealt with fear. You just keep speaking to yourself. You can do it. It's possible you can do it. Or like Thomas the Tank Engine, I think I can. I think I can. Therefore, you can. You kind of visualize your success. There's some real issues with that way of thinking. If you banish your fears like there's nothing to be afraid of, you really are living out of touch with reality. And why do I say that? Because we actually live in a dangerous world. Bad things can and will happen to us. There are no guarantees that nothing bad will happen to you today. For those of you that have never been robbed, I'll never forget the first time my wife called me when we were living over in the other part of Tampa, and she told me that our home had been robbed. Before that, I thought, we'll never be robbed in our house. In fact, I never locked the house door before, really. That's not really living in reality. Here's what many of us Christians do when it comes to this story. We summon up this Goliath-type courage. If I am a good Christian, you know, I still sin, I still make mistakes, but if I repent of my sin, if I go to church regularly, if I pay my tithe and put my tithe in the offering plate, all things we ought to do, by the way, if I do those things, that God's really not going to let anything really bad happen to me. That's how many of us think often. Here's the problem. Look at the biblical heroes in Scripture. John the Baptist, whom Jesus says was the greatest man that ever lived up until that point of time. Oh yeah, he was beheaded at a young age. Jesus himself, he was perfect. He never ever sinned. Nothing bad should have happened to him, right? Oh yeah, he was crucified at the ripe old age of 33. Goliath, from the human perspective, what caused Goliath to lose his battle? From the human perspective, I know God was in charge of all this. His self-esteem was too high. He had a counterfeit courage. He was trusting in the wrong thing. He came to believe that nothing bad would happen to him, especially when he saw this David walk out there with simple sling. He should have watched the Star Trek movies, which teach you never to let your shield down, right? He knew that a sling was a weapon. In fact, Roman literature tells you that if you threw one of those slings, that stone would go over 60 miles an hour. Some sources say a sling was more dangerous than an arrow. Goliath would have known that, and he would have seen that David had a sling. But he had this counterfeit courage. He was out of touch with being in danger. Now, I know there are many times that you and I are called to muster up courage. If there's a building that's burning down and your child is in there or someone else's child is in there, you may be the person who musters up the courage to go in and get your child to safety. That's courage for the short term. But if a doctor comes into your hospital room and says, you got a disease and it looks like it's fatal, how do you deal with that? That's not something you can simply muster up the courage to face it or to deny it's ever happened or ever said that. You'd be out of touch with reality. How do we become men of people of faith, of courage in the Christian life? Now, being from Chicago, I love the story of Frank Loesch. He was a believer, and he was a member in the Presbyterian Church, no less, in Chicago to boot. He was not a very imposing-looking man, but in Chicago, he was and probably still is a living legend, for he was the man who stood up to Al Capone. In the Prohibition years, Capone's rule was absolute. The local, the state police, even the FBI would not even touch him. They were afraid of him. But single-handedly, Frank Loesch, a Christian layman in a church, without any government support, organized the Chicago Crime Commission, a group of citizens who were determined to take Mr. Capone to court and put him away. During the months they met, you know the story. His life was in constant danger. His family was threatened. His life was threatened, but he never wavered. Ultimately, he won the case against Capone and was the instrument for removing that blight against Chicago. As a believer, he risked his life to live out his faith. So the question is, how do we live lives of courage like that? What really is the only way to that kind of courage? Because fear is emotion. We got to deal with it on a daily basis. Note, first, the faltering courage of the reigning king, the counterfeit courage of the rival king, and lastly, the available courage of the soon-to-be king. The available courage of the soon-to-be king. Saul in this story gives his own armor to David after agreeing to let him go out and fight him. Let me read you verses 38 to 40 one more time. Then Saul clothed David with his armor. He put a helmet of bronze on his head and clothed him with a coat of mail, and David strapped his sword over his armor, and he tried in vain to go, for he had not tested them. Then David said to Saul, I cannot go with these, for I have not tested them. So he put them off. Then he took his staff in his hand and chose five smooth stones from the brook and put them in his shepherd's pouch. His sling was in his hand, and he approached the Philistine. What gave David the courage to do this? You got to see what he really represents. Now, I know when we read this story, we all want to be like David. But ultimately, it's not about that, because in this story, who becomes our champion? David does. He is representing us. The person we should identify with most are the Israelites, those men who are cowering in fear with King Saul. What does God give us when we're afraid? He doesn't say, come on, pick yourself up by your bootstraps, get out there and fight the battle. He doesn't even give us an example. He gives us a champion. He gives us a savior. When David won this battle, Israel was saved. The war was over. David doesn't say to the troops, I'm going to go fight down and kill Goliath. And as soon as I kill Goliath, you come follow me. We're going to kill everybody. In this story, David is the deliverer. He's the champion. He's the savior. So here's David going out with a sling. He goes out in weakness compared to what Goliath had. He wasn't even a trained warrior. And I say that to show you this morning that David did not win in spite of his weaknesses. I'm telling you, he won because of his weakness. Because he was weak. That's why Goliath let his shield down. Again, from Robert Alter, he says this, David does not win in spite of his weakness. He wins through his weakness. He wins because of his weakness. We talked about this last week in the previous chapter when David's being anointed by Samuel at David's father Jesse's house. David wasn't even in the house when Samuel arrives, but the seven older brothers were. And after Samuel kept asking, is this guy going to be king? God could say, not him, not him, not him. And Samuel finally asked, do you have any other children? Do you have any other sons? And Jesse's response was, they're still the runt of the litter. He's out back. And what David went through in his upbringing was because he knew his weakness. He knew there was a savior, and he knew what was going on. He was actually fit to be king. So David goes out to fight Goliath as a representative for his people, as a substitute for them. You see, to be a champion was a legal thing. Fast forward to the 21st century. If you're on trial for something that's really important in your life, you're going to hire an advocate, a defense attorney. He's your advocate. He represents you. If he wins, you win the case. If he loses, you lose the case. What happens to the advocate, your lawyer, really is imputed to you. David was fighting as a champion, as a legal representative for the people of Israel. If he won, the people won. If he lost, the people lost. In other words, he was not just fighting for them, he was fighting as them. You see what that means? God, in sending David out there, was not just sending us an example. He was sending a Savior, a deliverer. Now, this actually gets a whole bunch better on top of this. In Hebrews chapter 11, we hear story after story of the great heroes of the faith. Moses, Abraham, Isaac, some ladies of the Bible, and David is there, the heroes of the faith. And then you get to Hebrews chapter 12. And remember, there's no delineation between chapters when this was written. Hebrews chapter 12, therefore, because we've been surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, all those heroes of the faith, let us fix our eyes on Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith. And do you know what that Greek word for perfecter is translated? It's champion. Our champion. So here's what's going on. Yes, we should look at David. Yes, we should glean a lot from him. But the ultimate point is he points us to the ultimate champion, the Lord Jesus Christ. Jesus is the one who comes and saves us. He is the one who came down to this earth, became weak. Weak enough to go to the cross, to die, to take the punishment we deserved. The reason he did this is so that when we believe in him, we can be made right with God and he can truly accept us. So you look at David, he defeated Goliath, thus saving the Israelites from physical bondage and slavery. Jesus dies on the cross to save us from spiritual death. David saved people at the risk of his life. Jesus saves us at the cost of his life. David went into the valley of the shadow of death, but Jesus went into the jaws of death itself. Do you see this? Whatever it is we fear the most, and we have those deep-seated fears, the loss of your health or your loved one, the loss of wealth or your career, guess what? Jesus took it on the cross. If there's a God and he created us, then without the cross, because of your sin, you're forever alienated from your creator. That is the ultimate nightmare. That is the ultimate fear. On the cross, Jesus took your ultimate nightmare and he conquered it. And it simply means this: if you believe in him this morning, you're safe. You have a champion. It doesn't mean that bad things won't happen to you, because they might, but it means that you have a champion, your champion who took on the stranglehold of death and was victorious over it. He paid the debt that we should have paid. He died the death that we should have died. He won the victory for us. And when you look at him, guess what? He makes available to us the courage that he gave David. And you know what the courage was? Basically to go to King Saul and said, "What is the matter with you, Saul? You're the king of Israel. Why aren't you out there facing this Goliath? You warriors, why aren't you out there doing that? If you won't go out there, I will go out there, because I will not let my God be mocked." He's like Esther. If I perish, I perish. So what? Doesn't mean he wasn't afraid. Of course he was. But he knew who his champion was. Now, how do you get there? Well, kind of Hebrews kind of tells us the answer, because true courage is not the absence of fear, but it's this: it's the assurance of joy. Why did Jesus come here in the first place? Hebrews 12, 1 and 2. Let me read you those verses. "Therefore, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us also lay aside every weight and sin which clings so closely, and let us run with endurance the race that is set before us, looking to Jesus, the founder and perfecter of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross." Who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is seated at the right hand of the throne of God. How could Jesus face the fear of being crucified? It was for the joy set before him. What joy? Did he not have everything before he came down to this earth? He was in perfect harmony with the triune God. There was nothing incomplete in Jesus. He had everything except us. Except us. So what Jesus was thinking about was that wedding feast day in the future, when all the saints are going to gather around at the wedding table. The joy set before him at the table when his saints will sit at the table and feast with the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. That's why he endured the cross. Our champion. So when we are in danger, our hearts won't necessarily falter. They won't fail. If you are deathly afraid of losing control, realize that Jesus lost control. If you're deathly afraid of humiliation, or you got to realize he experienced greater humiliation. If you're deathly afraid of disapproval, or the loss of a loved one, or discomfort, Jesus has experienced it all. And so as you face your fears, you have this courage that is available for you. Jesus died that you might have it. Why? Because his victory is our victory. His affirmation is our affirmation. His exaltation is our exaltation. So when we stumble and we falter, and we will, we have to remember we have a champion. Jesus, our representative, the author and perfecter of our faith. And because that is true, you can do what is just and good and right, even at the risk of your own life, even at the cost of your own life, because it came at the cost of our champion. At the end of that trilogy, The Return of the King and The Lord of the Rings, by J.R. Tolkien, Arwen is the niece of the king, and she's confronted by the Lord of the Nazgul. The Nazgul is this giant, dark, demonic creature. And the king is injured and cannot defend himself, and the Nazgul is coming. The only thing that stands between the king and the Nazgul is Arwen, the king's niece. And the Nazgul says this, "Come not between the Nazgul and his prey, or he will not slay thee in thy turn. He will bear thee away to the houses of lamentation beyond all darkness, where thy flesh shall be devoured and thy shriveled mind be left naked to the littlest eye." I have no idea what that means, but I'm pretty sure I don't want to find out. But then Arwen, a sword rang as it was drawn. "Do what you will, but I will hinder it. Be gone if you be not deathless for living or dark and dead. I will smite you if you touch him." Her eyes, gray as the sea, were hard and foul, and yet tears were on her cheek. A sword was in her hand, and she raised her shield against the horror of her enemy's eyes. The courage and the valor in the face of danger, and most likely her death. But what's amazing about that story is the effect it has on one of the hobbits named Merry. Tolkien writes about how he responds to this show of valor and heroism. You know, Tolkien before had written that the Nazgul was such a horror that it made Merry blind and sick, and he writes this, "Very amazement conquers Merry's fear. Pity filled his heart and great wonder, and suddenly the slow kindled courage of his race awoke. He clenched his hand and said, 'She should not die so fair, so desperate. At least she should not die alone, unaided.'" You see, when we look to what Jesus has done for us, the one who went to the valley of destruction to destroy death and sin itself at the cost of his life, because he is victorious, we have available to us the ability to live courageously as Christians. And the only way possible to do that is to look at Jesus Christ, our champion, because maybe our slow kindled courage will awake too. Jesus, our champion. Amen. Let's pray. Father, I do thank you for your word. I thank you for bringing it home to me even the past couple weeks as I studied this. It is such a familiar passage, and I ask that you would use it in our hearts, not to frustrate us, to think about the times we fail in courageous acts, but to simply turn our eyes to Jesus, the author and the true champion of our faith. May we trust more in him today than ever before. And I pray this in his name. Amen. Let's stand together as we close.
Holiness, I will sing a song of your faithfulness.
day that you have made to walk in your love and your grace. For I will sing to you, my King, forever and ever. I will rise up and worship your holy.
So much for coming this morning. If you would like to pray, there'll be a couple elders up here after the service. If you have prayer, please say for the Sunday school hour that follows, and now receive the blessing and benediction from God Himself. Now to Him who is able to do far more abundantly than all we ask or think, according to the power at work within us, to Him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever. And may He continue to work in us what is pleasing to Him. And all God's people said, Amen.